Hallelujah. What a blessing it is for me to be with you this morning and to have the opportunity and the privilege, responsibility. And can this go down? Yes. Good. So you can see me. If I don't lower it, then you won't be able to see me, just hear me probably. Now, we're going to be doing this training, and I believe that the Lord is, we are just praying and excited for what the Lord is about to do in Pittsburgh, or doing in Pittsburgh, I should say, because God is moving in this city. I hope and we pray that you realize that there is a harvest ready in the city. And all we need to do is to get ready and go out and get the harvest for the Lord. Believe me, that's what's happening in the spirit. There is a harvest in the city of Pittsburgh that needs to be gathered, that needs to be picked for the kingdom of God. And he's looking for people like you, people like Pastor Patrick and his wife, Hermana or Sister Robin. Pastors, leaders who are seeking after his heart, God's heart, and willing and open to do what it takes to do God's will in the city. So that's the heart of this teaching and the heart of what I want to share with you this morning. And I believe that the Lord is going to speak to you, and that's our prayer, that he's going to start speaking to you and revealing to you and empowering you to do what he has called all of us to do. Evangelism, or taking the gospel to the nations, is not a special call for special people. It is God's mandate for his people to teach and preach the gospel where we are and even to the ends of the world. And we're going to go through all that. But I must confess, we are not going to have enough time to cover this subject. It really does take some time to cover the whole subject, the whole idea of evangelism and how to witness to people and how to get ready for that, and then how to lead them in prayer, and then how to bring them to church, to our meetings, and then have them developed in their faith and discipled and equipped and trained and released into ministry. And I don't know if you are going to be able to read with me from that screen. It looks a little, can you, or do I need glasses? It looks a little small, and it looks a little blurry too, I think. Doesn't it? No? You can see it? Okay. So, you know, this is our Lord Jesus Christ saying to us, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. That's what he said. That's what he said to the disciples, and that's what we read in scriptures. Now, what happens today is that I have the scriptures on these slides, and my hope it is that you will be able to, I don't have a handout for that, for this presentation right now. You will have a handout for the following presentation, which is coming very soon, and you will get this in a moment. But for that, I don't have a handout. But I would like to go to those scriptures, if you don't mind. It can take some time. Or would you rather me quote scriptures and go over the passages and the ideas of the scriptures? Because if we go to every scripture I am putting there, it's going to take us more time. So let's go with this. Overcoming fear, number one. I want to share with you, and I want to talk with you about overcoming fear. You know, the Bible says, and you have the scripture reference there, 2 Timothy chapter 1. The Bible says that God has not given us a spirit of fear. Now, we need to understand that fear then is not an accident. Fear is not a situation. If you read the scripture, what Paul is saying is the spirit, there is a spirit of fear that paralyzes people. Right? So when you feel like you are fearful, you are not dealing with just one thought or one emotion. You are dealing with a spirit. Now, I don't want to bring a dogma or build a doctrine over just one passage or one scripture. But you know, because you've been there, I've been there. There is times when you feel, you know, there is fear beyond your own control and beyond what you can manage. When you face that fear, you know you are not just facing a situation. Like, oh, you're going to hit a car. Oh, that kind of fear. You know, that's not a spirit of fear. That's a circumstance you're facing. But when you are trapped, like you are not able to do anything, and you doubt, and you are afraid, and you fear for your life, and you fear for, if you are fearful, then you are dealing with a spirit of fear. Now, I need to tell you this. That's exactly what the North American church is facing today. You are facing, we are facing a spirit of fear when it comes to evangelism and sharing your faith. Because everyone, we have not, with my wife, we have not met one single North American in these almost 2 years that we've been in Pittsburgh that has not said the same words. Oh, no, don't share. Don't tell people. You don't want to offend people. This is a spirit. People are afraid of telling the good news to others. And so Paul is saying, we have not been given the spirit of fear, but the spirit of power and love and self-control. So it is in the Holy Spirit that we do what we do for the Lord. And if anything is stopping you from fulfilling God's will, then you are dealing with opposition to the will of God. So we need to overcome the spirit of fear in our minds and in our hearts. Nothing will happen to you. You don't live, we don't live in a country where they will put you to jail or behead you or kill you. So we don't need to be afraid. And then let's say if that happens, let's say if that will to happen to us in this country, well, we have lots of scriptures and promises from the Lord saying, if you give your life for my sake, you actually win your life, right? Now, those scriptures apply to our brothers and sisters in Egypt today, and in Libya, in Israel, in Jordan, in Iraq, but they don't apply to us. No, they apply to us too. And that's exactly what the Lord is asking us to do, to follow him. At the moment he called the disciples, at the very same moment that he said, follow me, he told them and he explained to them what it means to follow him. And following Jesus means and continues to mean today to us, we may lose our family. You remember the scriptures? He says, I didn't come to bring peace, but I came to bring sword. And you will have fathers going against children because of my sake. Now, am I saying to you, you go out and you start a problem? No, I'm not saying that. Am I saying to you, we should go and make people upset and make them mad towards us and against God and church? I'm not saying that. But when we preach the gospel, when we tell people about their need for salvation and what the Lord has done for them, sometimes people get a little nervous. Sometimes people don't like it. Sometimes, but that's very, very little. That doesn't really happen. Because you will see. We will see. So we need, number two, we need to not only overcome fears, but we also need to defeat lies. That's the second thing we have found with my wife during this time here in the States. The North American church is believing lies. And what is the lie? The number one lie that the church in the U.S. believes when it comes to sharing Christ with unsaved, with lost people, with relatives, with people outside the church, the number one lie is they don't want to hear. They don't want to hear you. They don't want to hear the gospel because it's private. That's a very private thing. So don't tell them because they don't want to hear. Don't say it. That's a lie. Because, you know, my wife and I, we're always out. We're always meeting people. We're always sharing. We're always trying to connect people with us and with God. You know, it only takes 5 minutes. It only takes us 5 to 10 minutes to start a conversation and go into the heart. People are desperate in this city. We have been seeing how hopeless people live in this valley. There is hopelessness, and we have words of hope for them. We have the message. We have the good news. We have what they need. We have words of reconciliation, restoration, deliverance, love, acceptance, and healing, and provision, and abundance, and life. We have these words. By what you say to a couple today, you may be saving a marriage. But what you say to someone today, you may be saving someone from committing suicide. I mean, we've seen that in our lives with my wife back in Guatemala and in other countries. And so we have the words that bring change and transformation and blessing to people. And they're waiting to hear those words. They have heard curses and bad things said over them enough for too long. And we have kept quiet. We are not going out telling them the good news of the gospel. So the number one lie we are seeing that Christians believe in the U.S. is people outside don't want to hear the gospel. But that's a lie. People outside the church, people without Christ, are waiting to hear the good news. Now, I need to say this now. When we tell the gospel, when we share the good news with people, you want to write this down and memorize it and remember it. Don't talk about your church. Talk about Jesus Christ. Don't talk about your church. What do I mean by that? Well, I mean that what happens is that when we think we are evangelizing, we think that we are telling people the gospel, what we are really doing is telling them, come to my church on Sunday. And I will have to agree with lost and unsaved people because I was one of them. I never wanted to go to a church, never, because I was a Jehovah's Witness. So I never wanted to go to a Christian meeting because to me, my understanding of the Bible back then and my relationship with Jehovah was that Christians were crazy and I don't want to say what they believe. So I never wanted to go to a Christian meeting. And that's true for most of the lost people. They don't want to go to a church. They don't want to go to a service. They don't want to go to a meeting in a church place like this. They don't. So when you tell them about Jesus and when you tell them about the gospel, you don't talk about your church. Talk about Jesus. And I will go over that later, but I wanted to make sure I said that clearly, and it will be good you write it and you remember it and you practice it. When you tell people about Jesus, don't talk about your church. Stay talking about Jesus. Go to the Bible. Tell them about the Lord, what he did, how he lived, the miracles, his power, what he's doing in your life, what he's done in your life, what he will do when he comes back. Tell them all about Jesus, not your congregation. There is a time when you talk about your congregation, of course, but not the first time. Not to bring people to Christ. Okay. Number three, warfare. Ephesians chapter 3, Paul says, verse 10, that we, the church, are now... I need to read this scripture because I don't have it in my mind memorized yet in English. But Ephesians 3, verse 10, Paul says that it is God's intent. I love the way this translation puts it. And I believe it is the NIV or the English Standard Version. I will see how it looks in this Bible. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10, Paul says, his intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. So when we pray, when we worship, when we evangelize, when we tell the gospel, when we preach to people. We are actually defeating the spirits that govern people and the environment. You know, Peter, Paul say that the ruler of this age is the devil. The world belongs to God and everything in it, but the devil has dominion over people and things. And so when we share the gospel, we are not just telling words. We are not just talking theories. We are not just telling stories. We are speaking life. We are speaking eternal life. We are speaking the oracles of God. We are speaking the wisdom of God. We are speaking the power of God to people, into people's lives, hearts, and minds, and souls. You may not realize it. We may not realize this. But when we share the gospel, when we proclaim the good news of what Jesus did and what Jesus is doing and what he plans to do, we are actually pushing darkness away and back. Now, don't you want that in your community? Don't you want that in your city? So we need to go out and preach the gospel. The reason why our communities are going through battles with drugs and suicide and depression and divorces and children running away and dropping out of school and homes being destroyed and marriages falling apart. The reason for that is not because the government is failing with programs. I believe that, and this is against me as a leader and as a pastor, we are not doing our part. We are not doing our service to our community, our country. When you share Christ, when we share Christ with others, that's a sign of loving people. We love people. We want to see them saved. We want to see them blessed, prospering, delivered and healed and restored. And we want to see them happy, right? Don't you want that for your neighbors? For your friends, we all want that. But the solution is the preaching of the gospel. We forgot that. So Paul says that now we need to, when we preach the gospel, we are actually speaking to darkness. Now that sounds like, oh brother, that's why we did the prayer walk, remember? And I asked Pastor Patrick, we need to continue doing that. And then we also need to start making a program to go out and look for search for the lost, look for the lost and find them and tell them and find creative ways of sharing the gospel with them. That's why we have these signs. You see the signs? I know you do. And we're not going to have you go out with one sign and follow me around. We won't do that today. But we will do it. But we will do it. And so when we do this, when we take the gospel to the streets, we go and we defeat because we are on the winning side. Jesus has conquered. He defeated the devil. He defeated death. He defeated sickness. He defeated the power of the devil. He's defeated. And he sends us as his representatives, as his ambassadors, to tell the world that he is the coming king. So when we take the gospel out to the streets, and I mean right now to the streets, literally, we are winning our communities back. That's what we are doing. So that's why we need to go out and pray. And I invite you that, last weekend, my wife and I had to go do some shopping. We all do shopping at the weekend, right? Food, clothes, everything, you go shopping. But we're always, and we're going to see that later, we always need to be prepared. We need to be proactively aware of this situation. We are, wherever we are sent by God. You need to understand that. If you are in the grocery store this afternoon, you are there because God sent you. And if he sent you there, he has a purpose for you there. Now you're going to go, now he lives, he thinks a little different. Yes, we do things differently. We think differently. Why? Because we are committed to seeing Jesus in the lives of people wherever we are. And that's the mentality we need to gain in Christ. We need to renew our understanding. You know the scripture that says that you don't belong to yourself anymore, right? You are not your own anymore, right? So you are not your own anymore. It's not me trying to have you believe something that I believe. I'm just saying to you what the Bible says to us. That's how we need to be living out our faith. So Paul says that when we take the gospel out, we are defeating. We are proclaiming and defeating darkness. And we are gaining back not only people, but even community, even spaces, even places. That's why we need to keep going prayer walking. But wherever you go. So last week we were out shopping with my wife and we were walking, and we shared this in our small group Thursday night. And you know what happens? There comes this vehicle. It was an SUV with young people drinking. And you know what they do? They pull over right where we were standing. We were waiting on the side of the curb side, waiting to cross the street. And they were flying, squeaking their wheels, their tires, driving, parking lot. And we're going, oh boy, Lord, please. You know, we're just watching vehicles, people walking across. And we see the car, you know, and we see young people in the car driving. We're going, oh please, Lord, you know. And they come right where we were, stop the car. And one of the guys comes out, drunk, young guy, very young guy. And he throws himself on the hood, you know, like playing that he was hit by the car, by his own friend. And he says, what do you want me to do? What do you want? And he's talking to me. And I, but he was, you know, trying to be funny with me and, you know, making me laugh. And I just went along. And I said, yeah, you need to be careful, you know. We're praying for you. He goes, you know, he gets in the car and they drive off. But my wife and I go, what was this about? You know, and at that very moment, Brian calls me on the telephone and I say, Brian, you wouldn't believe what's happening right here. You know why? Because God is always putting us in the middle of situations where he wants us to be. Now, we need to be conscious of this all the time. It takes practice, it takes discipline, and that's why I believe Pastor Patrick is wanting us to come and share with you, because we need to be transformed. We need to be renewed in our understanding. I think that one of the reasons, or not one, but the main reason why we are doing this is because we want to see people saved, and we want to see people restored and renewed and delivered and prospered. Number four, read your Bible. We need to read our Bible. If we want to win souls for Christ, we need to read the Bible. We need to know the scriptures. We need to know. Peter says that we need to be prepared all the time to be able to give an account of our faith to those who demand it. And when we go out, that's why I said we don't talk about church or our church or denomination in this case. We don't talk about that. It's not that I don't want you to believe in your denomination or your church. No, please, don't misunderstand me. But I want to repeat that again. Don't talk about your church, because that's what keeps people away. Because you know what happens also? People outside our Christian community, they know what happens here, and they don't understand. They know that some of us fail. They know that some of us have very bad weaknesses. They know that some of us don't live up to the standards. They know that, but they don't understand. They see that. And so the very first thing they do when we start talking about our church is they want to start talking about people in the church. And if you go down the street, it's difficult to come out good, because they are correct. We in this community, I don't know anybody, but so I'm using myself. I have weaknesses. I'm not perfect. God is at work in me. I will fail you if you spend time. I will fail you. I will make you, I will fail you. But they don't know that. They don't understand that we, all of us, are in a process of being delivered and being saved and restored and being made holy in Christ. They don't know that. So don't talk about church. Talk about Jesus, because he never fails and he is perfect, right? So number four, read the Bible. That's why we need to read the Bible. And that's another big thing that we are seeing with my wife here. People don't know the scriptures. People in Christian circles talk more about cultural things, believing that's the Bible. And it is not the Bible. I will give you an example, which is very cultural. And you may think that I have a problem with that. And I do have a problem with that because of what the Bible says. When you let your children grow without any authority and direction and morals and, why not, rules, which not only happens in Christian homes, it happens in this country. Children are being let alone. They have their own, psychology has found its way into even Christian circles. Or you have to let the little one develop, because they have to have their own psychology. They have to find, and I don't know what else to say, but that's the idea. What can a little one know about life and wisdom? Little children, they're so beautiful. I have two beautiful daughters, but they're grown-ups now. But when they were little, they were so beautiful. Look, just like yours, they're beautiful. But they don't know anything. They need to be led. They need to be taught. They need to be guided. They have to. But in psychology, in this country, no, you let the little children do whatever. And so you see little children and young people in Christian circles do whatever, because that's what, but that's not what the Bible teaches. So that's cultural. But when I talk with families in the U.S. and they tell me that that's normal and acceptable, I'm going, we are going, but that's not what the Bible says in raising kids. So I'm not trying to bring my Guatemalan culture into your culture. I'm speaking, and I am talking about the Bible. That's why we need to read the Bible if we want to go out and share the gospel, because we don't talk about what I think or my philosophy or my idea, but we talk about what the scripture teaches, right? So that's why we need to read the Bible if we want to go out and share the gospel. And 2 Timothy chapter 2, now I can read it. Thank you, Falco. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, Paul is telling Timothy, you need to be studying all the time. That's what he tells Timothy. You need to be prepared and show yourself approved as a good workman, as a good worker, not needing to be ashamed, but someone who knows to handle the scriptures well. So if you want to share Christ, we have some work, homework to do. And that will be reading and memorizing and knowing what the scripture says. Okay? Let's go to the next slide. Falco, please. There you go. Thank you. Number five, memorize scriptures. Psalms 119 says, in my heart I have hidden your word. That means I know the by heart. Someone recently asked me, how do you know the Bible in English too? Well, I read the Bible in English and I memorize it in English. That's the only reason why I know how to do this, because I have to practice my English. And it's good that internet works, because you can read and you can hear. As you read, you hear, okay, that's good. So I memorize. So you need to memorize. We need to memorize scriptures. And if I do it in English, not my native language, you can do it. English is your language. It takes me double effort to be able to memorize it and then say it, as you can tell. but I'm working on it. So we need to memorize scriptures to be able to go out and tell people about Jesus. Number six, we need to develop a heart for the lost. Now, these steps, I call them baby steps. These are baby steps for personal evangelism. And I am talking about personal evangelism. That is, each one of us getting ready, doing these six, eight baby steps, preparing our lives, preparing our hearts to share the gospel with people, one-on-one. Now, why I'm encouraging you to do it one-on-one? Because that's what the Bible teaches us. The Bible teaches us that we need to do it one-on-one. Now, there is different things or ideas called evangelism or relational friendship evangelism. We're going to go over that later on. But we need to develop a heart for the lost. We all need to develop a heart for the lost. Matthew chapter 9, verse 36. The Bible says that when Jesus saw the multitudes, he had compassion over them. Other versions say he was moved with compassion. He was moved with compassion for them. And I need to make a comment here. The North American church, I'm a missionary guy. Our ministry has to do with different nations. As you know, we just came back from Israel. I'm going to Cuba in June. I'm going back to Guatemala in June. Then in July, I'm going back to Israel. And then in October, we might be going to China. And in November, I'm going to Turkey. So our ministry has to do with missionaries in different countries. But now we live in the U.S. So the U.S. is my Jerusalem. So I need to be making disciples in my Jerusalem, which is Pittsburgh. That's why we are doing this. But what I want to say in regards to developing a heart for the lost and reading Matthew chapter 9, verse 36, where Jesus is moved with compassion for the lost, for the multitude, I want to say this in regards to mission. The reason why the North American church is declining in sending missionaries, in supporting financially your missionaries, is because we lost the heart for the lost. We don't have a heart for the lost. We don't have compassion for the people anymore. We have pity. I mean, there are so many programs in this country, government level and church level, nonprofit organizations, that only give people help for the day. It's good. I mean, I'm not going to speak against that. I mean, that's wonderful. I believe that's one of the responsibilities of the church also. And so that's why you see in the churches food pantries, food programs, clothing programs. I know that. That's wonderful. But the reason why the North American church is not sending missionaries anymore and supporting missionaries financially anymore and praying for the nations anymore is because we have lost our heart of compassion for the lost here. What we are seeing is, okay, Pastor Patrick will say today is Sunday, okay, we're going to give food and clothes away. And so you bring it over, and then the church has an office, and people know about the church office, and so they come to the office and they get the food or the help they need. And by you bringing to the building, to the church, in the week, what you want to give away, you feel like you are helping. And you are helping, but you are helping just in a very small way. We are not to feed the people and to clothe the people only. We need to preach the gospel to them. But by doing these programs, what we do is I disengage. I don't take part in it anymore because the office, in this case, Pat, will do it, I think. I don't know if they come to Pat and they say, I need food. Okay, Pat goes down and she's, okay, what do you need? A can? Okay, take it. Go. Goodbye. Bye. Right? I'm not saying that's bad. The bad side of this is that you, the individual, You are not being moved with compassion for this neighbor who is in need. Yes, he needs to survive today, and let's help them survive today. But wouldn't it be better to help them find a way out? And the number one step, the number one thing they need is the message of the gospel. That's why I love this one. I love this one. Jesus gives us hope for the future. If you know Jesus, if you know what he says about you and what he does for you and what he has, that gives you hope. And that makes you want to live. And I want to fight for my life. And I know I have a future. I know I have a promise. I know I have God on my side. Now he is not only God up there somewhere, but he becomes my Father. Oh, wow. That changes the situation. You may feel me for the day, but you are setting me free. So we need to develop a heart for the lost. And that's what Jesus did in Matthew chapter 9. If you read Matthew chapter 9, verse 35, the Bible says, Jesus went through all the towns and villages. I love that. He went through. Other versions say he walked, because that's what he had to do. He had to walk through every town and village. You know why he did it? Because that was the only way he could do it? No, he went through every town and every village. When he went through the Samaritans, he didn't go around the Samaritans like all the Pharisees did, right? He went through the town of Samaria because he wanted to see the people. He wanted to be where the people were, developing a heart for the lost. And that happens when we go out and prayer walk. You see the faces of the people. You see the houses where they live. You see the streets. The first time we came with my wife to visit you one Sunday morning a couple of months ago, we were driving and we saw the streets and we went, whoa. It's so desperate, the environment, spiritually. And we said, oh, Lord, please, please. You know, we want to do something here. We didn't know how this was going to develop. But we need to develop a heart for the lost. And so, because we don't have a heart for the lost here, there's no way you can catch a vision for the lost on the other side of the world. If you don't care for the very need we have in our backyard, there's no way we're going to be able to care for the needs of others on the other side of the world. Now, there are some that do, but I'm speaking for us as a whole body of believers. We need to develop a heart for the lost. Number 7, keep your eyes on the harvest. Keep your eyes on the harvest. Acts chapter 18. You know what was happening there? Paul, the apostle Paul, was going through. He was on a ship, and the ship was about to get shipwrecked. And I'm practicing my verbs, huh? And an angel of the Lord comes to him and says, You will survive. Nobody will die. You should be okay. You will be okay. Paul, everything will be lost, but you will be okay. Because why did God save Paul at that moment? Because I have many people in this city. And that's what he's saying to us. He has many people in this city. That's why he's saving us. That's why he's calling us. That's why he's talking to us, speaking to us, because he has many people he wants to save in the city. So we need to keep our eyes on the harvest. Keep your eyes on the harvest, not on the government, not on what the government doesn't do for the city, not on what is happening in this. Don't do that. Keep your eyes on the harvest, the people that God is preparing to bring to salvation. And then number 8, and I will have to, do I have a break here? You tell me. Okay, but number eight now, the reality of hell. we have forgotten. You know why we have forgotten about hell? Because you and I have been saved from it. So we don't need to care. We don't need to remember such place. And I will tell you part of my testimony right now. That's one of the very reasons why I came to Christ. Because I was afraid of dying. I had no risk of dying when I was 18 years of age. I was okay. I mean, it was never a risk. But in my heart, in my soul, I was so afraid of death. Or like you won't believe, I couldn't sleep. I could not sleep at all. Since I was 16 years of age, I started having dreams every night. As soon as I went to sleep, as soon as I got in my bed, I began having dreams about me falling in a precipice, in a big, big hole, dark. And it never ended. It never ended. And I kept falling on my back. And I kept falling, going down. It never ended. I never touched the bottom. But I knew, I was able to see, I don't know how I did this, but this was my imagination, it was the spirit of fear, it was God calling me, whatever it was, but I'm just telling you, I was afraid of dying, and every time I went to bed every night, for 2 years, every time I closed my eyes, I started dreaming this ugly dream. I was falling on my back, but I was able to see the things at the bottom. And I knew that I was going to fall, and I was going to be, you know, what do you call those sticks, like spikes? Yes, spikes. And I knew I was falling on there, and I was gone. I didn't want to sleep. I did not want to go to bed. Night, it was horrible for me. Now, you know what I did? I read. I like to read. That's when I acquired this habit of reading. I like to read, and because I didn't want to sleep. I was afraid of dying, and I didn't know about hell at all. I was attending the Jehovah's Witnesses, and they go against the teaching of hell. They go against. We forget about hell, because we were saved from it. We are not going there anymore because of what he did for us, right? And we get so comfortable because the blessings and the prosperity that God brings into our lives, and how good and how blessed and how happy, how joyful it is to be serving God and knowing him. It is so wonderful. We only think about heaven, and heaven is going to be a glorious place, and we are getting to enjoy heaven even now because his presence is with us, his promises, his blessings. So we forget about hell because we are so comfortable in our blessings that we only think about heaven. And then some have also forgotten about heaven because earth is such a good place now for many of us. So we don't care. We don't care anymore. I'm saved. Number one, I'm okay. I have eternal life, right? I'm going to heaven. Okay, that's wonderful. So I don't have to think about hell. But hell, it's a real place. It's in scriptures. And people without Jesus are going to hell. And that's a horrible place. I remember it. And I don't want anybody to go there. And I know you don't want anybody to go there either. But you know what they say? No, don't say those things. That's what they tell me. Many, many, many people here say, don't talk about that because that gets people afraid. That gets people offended. That pushes people away. People don't want to hear you. People don't want to come. That's why we only give these other kind of messages. Light messages. The light gospel. And you don't talk about condemnation, you don't talk about punishment, you don't talk about the wrath of God, you don't talk about the character of God and the justice of God, because that's too heavy. People don't want to hear that. People need to hear that. On the one hand, we need to take the good news of the gospel, good news, The good news is Jesus, the Son of God, came to live a perfect life, a holy life, and he died for me because I am a sinner. I deserve condemnation and eternal punishment. I deserve to be sent to hell. I deserve to be thrown into the lake of fire. I deserve all that. But because Jesus died for me, and now I believe in him, and I have given him my life, and he is my Lord, now I'm not going to hell anymore. That's the good news. My sins are forgiven. My name is written in the book of life, right? I've been washed by the blood, with the blood of the Lamb. Now I can have a relationship with God, and now he is my Father. Those are the good news we need to tell people. And while we wait for him, he wants to bless me, he wants to deliver me, he wants to heal me, he wants to make me happy. Yes, he wants me to rejoice in him. He wants me to have peace. He wants me to have an abundant life. Yes, he has all that for me. That's the good news. Now, there is another side to the good news. If you don't believe, and the Bible says that if you don't believe, this, and then you can tell them, is going to happen. So the message, it's a complete message. We are forgetting to take the whole message out to the people. That's what we are doing. We are forgetting it. So we need to take the good news, but we also need to tell them the admonition from scriptures and give them the warning. Ezekiel chapter 33, we are the watchmen on the wall. We are the watchmen on the wall for our city, for our community. We are the ones who tell them, get ready. Get ready. There is a way out. There is victory. There is a king coming, a kingdom coming. His name is Jesus. And if you are on his side, you're victorious. You will be okay. But if you don't, then this is also happening. We are the watchmen on the walls. Ezekiel chapter 33. So the good news is that that's what we need to tell people. But we don't want to hide away. We don't want to keep it a secret that there is also an eternal punishment, place for punishment. That is hell. Okay? So let's take a break. Let's pray right now. And I have a handout. What time?
Just take a 5-minute
break. But let's pray for.
Break shortly.
Okay.
Just stand, stretch your legs a few minutes. If you need
yes.
To go to the bathroom there, and then.
Yes. Okay. Let's just pray, and then we take our break. Father God, we thank you. Thank you for your presence in our midst this morning. Thank you for your Spirit speaking to us. Thank you for your Word speaking to our hearts and spirits and minds. And Lord, I know that you are doing what you love doing. And that's sending your Spirit to awake your people. Thank you, Lord, for awakening us today. Thank you for speaking to us. Thank you because you love us. That's why you speak to us. And Lord, we rejoice over the fact that you love us and you call us your children. And so we rejoice and we thank you because you are inviting us to be co-laborers with you, to be your ambassadors, to be your hands and your feet and your mouth to our community, to Glassport and to Pittsburgh and even to the nations. Lord, thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for equipping us. And thank you for giving us your Spirit to equip us and to release us to do the works of the ministry. We praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to have a break in about 30 minutes. And so for the time being, we kind of just rearranged things because we want to give Amilcar our whole second half. And he had asked me to share just a few things this morning. So I gave you some notes, and I'm pretty, don't always do it, but I'm getting back in the habit again of giving you life notes. And so we're going to talk about identifying the harvest. Or let's make it personal, okay? My harvest. Where is my harvest? In John 4, 34 and 35, you have it in your life notes there, said, Jesus said to me, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say they are still four months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for harvest. You know, and you know, I've read that verse hundreds of times, and I'm sure most of you here in this room, you've read that verse many times. But there was a phrase that really stuck out that perhaps maybe I haven't seen as often as I should, and it's the last phrase, for they are already white the harvest. They are already, even though, I mean, we know that we plant and then we look forward to a harvest. God is telling us and that God is preparing hearts even as we're talking right now. And I think that's what he wants us to hear, and that's what he wants you to know, that even as we're here, we are preparing our hearts, our lives, to be able to share the good news. But do we realize that right now that there are people that are ready to hear the good news of Christ? That God, in his manifold ways in which he can reveal himself, do you know that the Holy Spirit is getting people ready right now to hear the message that he's laying upon our heart? And so in your life, there's those who have to fill in all the blanks. God is preparing hearts right now. The harvest is ready. Are the harvesters ready? And that's what we're here to do today, right? We are here today to what? To be a part of that. And verses 36 and 38 really tells us about what I just mentioned. Even though we may not know how God is doing it, like you, your heart was being prepared because you were having dreams. I came to Christ because of fear as well, okay? But the Holy Spirit is preparing hearts, and I believe that with all my heart. In Matthew 9, 27 and 28, we made reference to chapter 9. But listen to what he says. Then Jesus said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful. There again, he's saying it's ready. It's ready, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. And let me just tell you, and just put down your name on that blank, because you're the answer. You're the answer to the Lord's prayer. This is the Lord's prayer. Do you know that? This is one of the Lord's prayers that he is teaching us, just like the Our Father prayer. That's the prayer that he was teaching us. This is the Lord's prayer. And his prayer is what? Is that workers. Okay? And so you and I, we are the answer. And so in your second part of your thing, thank you, Pat. Pat made this up for me because I am not near. I cannot do this stuff on a computer. But Pat did this for me, to identify the harvest. And that's what we want to do just for a few moments. Something that let's just be practical as we possibly can. Let's read the scripture in Acts 1:8. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you shall be, what? My witnesses. Witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. I believe that in these verses in your life notes that Jesus outlines how the great harvest is going to be harvest, how it will be gathered. And it is the strategy of the New Testament church, okay? And he lays that out. But now we know that with the church because we hear messages all the time about that, right? Now I want to talk about us as disciples because I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. You are. I believe that Jesus, certainly he is talking to his church, but he's talking to what? People in his church. He's talking to us. We are his disciples. So what I believe and what the Holy Spirit laid upon my heart, which I never really thought of before, and so I'm trusting that it's God. It isn't just my own imagination. I'm not coming up with something really weird here. So if it's something weird, you come and let me know, okay? But I believe here that as it relates to my life, there is stages of evangelism. I believe that as we get saved, you know, we don't go to the ends of the earth. But I believe that here he's laying out that there is a evolution of how God moves us into soul winning. And it begins with what? Jerusalem? What is our Jerusalem? Now, we know that as a church, our Jerusalem is what? It's our community right here. But what is your Jerusalem? As a Christian, yes, as a part of this church, yes, it is Glassport, but as a Christian, and so as I was looking at this here, I believe that what the Lord is telling us, that witnessing and sharing the gospel begins where? In our Jerusalem. And so we have two questions there. And as you see that, we're kind of buzzing through this quick, but it's practical. What would your Jerusalem, what would Jerusalem represent in your life? Go ahead. There you go. Isn't it? I mean, that's what this whole thing is about, right? Is that we're here to what? Falco, what was the title of that thing? Reaching? We had a little title about this whole training here. Reaching our friends, our family and friends for Christ, right? Isn't that right? Somewhere along there, isn't there something about that? Special emphasis. Winning our family and friends for Christ. Okay, that was what I was looking for. So, Jerusalem. God has called us to be disciples. And he's called us to make disciples. Now, what I'm trying to say, where would that begin in your life? Where would that begin in your life? I believe that very naturally, that it would begin where? Right in your own home. Right with your close friends, people that already know you. That's your Jerusalem. And so I believe that the Lord has called you as a disciple, as a Christian. He's calling you to recognize, and I pray that you recognize that before we finish here, just this session, that you would begin to recognize that what is my Jerusalem? I remember when I got saved, and I didn't really start going into D.C. and witnessing to people I didn't know, okay? But I began to what? I began to share Christ with what? With my family. It was, it's like I didn't have to really be told about that. It just seemed to be that was like natural, I'm saved, and now I wanted what? I wanted my family to be saved. I wanted my brothers and my sister to know Christ. My close friends. And so what would Jerusalem represent in your life? Well, your friends and your family. That's the most basic, that's the starting point. And like Amilcar was saying, I don't believe that we'll ever have a heart for the world like we can until we have a heart for our Jerusalem. My Jerusalem. Your Jerusalem. A new disciple of Christ would start, that would be where he would start. Billy Graham, and all of us know about Billy Graham, right? What is one of the things that he says? One of the first things that he says to people who come and give their life to Christ. Well, there's lots of things he's like, okay, start reading your Bible, go to church, all those kinds. But do you know what else he says? Almost at every single meeting, he says, now I want you to go tell somebody. He said, I want you now to go tell somebody what Christ did for you. Because, see, that's what a disciple does. That's what a Christian does. In the starting place for all of us is what? Our Jerusalem. Your friends and your family. And I truly believe, now just think about this. And now there's a lot of weird things going on there. There's a lot of stuff you see on TV. Who do you think that your friends and your family would listen to more? You? Or someone they don't even know? I believe that many of them, I'm not saying all of them, but I believe that many of our friends and our family members would listen to you far more than they might listen to a preacher on TV. Or they might listen to a stranger that they have never seen and they come up to them on the street, do you know Jesus or whatever. It begins in our Jerusalem, identifying. You know, that's really kind of where this starting point is. This is where we're starting today. And we're trusting and believing that this isn't the end of what we want, because we, as we understand that, and as we are doing that, and we're seeing our Jerusalem reached, and even in the Bible, Jerusalem was being reached, and they got comfortable with Jerusalem. And so God brought a what? A persecution. God began, allowed persecution to come because they weren't finished, because then they were still what? Judea. And then there was what? Samaria. And then what? And then the uttermost parts of the world. And so, as believers here, as disciples, it begins with our Jerusalem. It begins with our family. And so let me just read some scripture, or maybe you know these things, and I'm not going to take the time to read all these things, but what are some examples so that we know what I'm saying is true? Remember Cornelius? Remember him in Acts chapter 10? He had the dream about you know, things that were unclean to a Jew, and yet God says, you know, hey, what I've said is clean is not unclean. And so he had a dream, and then God told him to ask Peter to come. But what you'll see as you read that in Acts chapter 10, that when Peter came and when he was sharing with him about the dream and about what it meant, do you know what Cornelius did? He had his relatives and his family present. When the jailer, remember that in Acts chapter 16, Paul and Silas went to Philippi. They were preaching the gospel. They cast out a demon of a young girl, then they were cast in jail. They were put in jail, chained to a wall, okay? At midnight, you know, they were having a praise and worship service. God shows up, you know, chains fall off, all that sort of stuff. You know, people are running out. And back in those days with those jailers, if you didn't do your job right, you died. Okay, that's why he took a sword out. I'm kind of paraphrasing the whole thing. He was going to kill himself because he knew, well, his boss was going to do it for him. And what did Paul say? Don't do that. And so Paul began to share with him Christ. And what did he say? What must I do to be saved? You know, he got glorious saved. And then what happened? He says, hey, I want you, and I'm paraphrasing, I want you to come now to my home. And I want you to, you know. He had, immediately, he was a new disciple of Christ, but what was he thinking about? What were some of his first thoughts? My family. My family, they do not know God. You know, And so you know the story. They're all baptized. And it became, you know, it just went from there. Andrew, remember Andrew the disciple? You know, there wouldn't have been a Peter without an Andrew. You know, we don't hear much of Andrew at all. There's no gospel according to Andrew. Nothing like that. No epistle written by Andrew. But we hear about Peter, don't we? We know a lot about Peter, you know, even though he didn't write a gospel, but first half of the book of Acts is about Peter, right? He was the rock. He was the principal disciple, apostle, right? But it wouldn't have been a Peter without Andrew, because Andrew who brought Peter. It was Andrew that when he heard the message of Christ, repentance of sins through John the Baptist. And when Jesus invited him to follow him, what did he do? He said, I got a brother. I got a brother, and he needs to hear about Jesus. Let me tell you, that's his Jerusalem. He began in his Jerusalem. And I would venture to say that all of the apostles began in their Jerusalem. They begin with their family and their friends, their close acquaintances. Philip, remember Philip? Just go down in John chapter 1 there. You'll follow a little bit longer. And then there's another. Okay, there's Philip. He's a disciple as well. And then he brings his friend, Nathaniel. Remember him? He was the one who said, Jesus, whatever, But Jesus knew who he was. He said, I saw you while you were over there. Remember that whole thing? Philip began with his what? With his Nathaniel. And so as we are talking about, winning the lost and reaching the lost, and maybe we're thinking about, and yet I believe that as we have a heart for our Jerusalem, and as we are beginning to do that and move out in that, God is going to move us to Judea. I really believe that. He's going to want us to be involved in people maybe we don't know. Or maybe that's people at work. Or my wife told me I needed to define who they might be, and maybe we will at another day. I really didn't put a whole lot of thought about that because I know about Jerusalem, and that's really the purpose of what we're meeting here today, is really what? Reaching our Jerusalem. And so as we are going to take like a 10-minute break, and I know that we only took a break about 30 minutes ago, but we're going to come back and we're going to have like another hour and 20 minutes or so of really, he's going to break down some good stuff for us, and then we're going to close our time this morning, and we're going to pray for you. We want to pray for everyone in this room, corporately and individually. We want to send you. We want to commission you, okay? And so that's going to be at the end, okay? But before we have a break, I want you to write down on that piece of paper. You can write it down on here, identifying your harvest. Remember, just the inner circle there, that line goes out is Jerusalem. That's your friends and family. The second one, the second circle, that's Judea, which I didn't define for you, so forgive me. And then the third one is Samaria, and then the ends of the earth. But I want you, if you would, just by that line, your friends and family, if you could just maybe write down maybe two or three names. Or there may be a family member, who isn't saved. And, maybe you witnessed them 10 years ago and just kind of whatever. Or maybe there's a friend. There's a close friend that you have. And, boy, you would love nothing more than anything else to see that friend in heaven, to be saved. Could you just write down maybe two or three or four names of your Jerusalem? Identify it. Identify your Jerusalem. Don't throw this paper away. Take it home and then begin to pray. Begin to pray for that, for your Jerusalem. This is my Jerusalem. And maybe, maybe God will expand it, and that's great. Maybe it starts off with three or four and it goes to a dozen. It's up to you. But write down the names, at least two to four names this morning, please. Of people, friends and family that you know who need Jesus. And let me tell you, I'm not trying to put you on a guilt thing, but I know it is God's will for you to reach your Jerusalem, to do all that you can. Now maybe you won't, maybe you will. We don't know because, amen, but we're trusting that God is getting them ready, and as we're praying, he's going to do that. And so, has everybody had time just to write down a few names? I'll just take a moment. Please write down a few names. Lord, these names of these people here are sisters, brothers, maybe moms and dads, maybe lifelong friends that we've known, and for whatever reason, and we're not here to condemn anyone. We're here to challenge, and you know, this is a new day, and Lord, we're just believing for them. God, we're believing for this is my Jerusalem. Lord, you said in your word that I will be your witness in Jerusalem. And we know that is meant more than just a geographic area, literally Jerusalem and Israel. But the family and the friends and those that you have brought me in relationship, Lord, that is my Jerusalem. And so, Lord, we just pray for them this morning, God. God, we're praying that you will burden our hearts. And I know that our hearts are burdened. I'm not trying to imply that they're not burdened. But, Lord, that we would begin to be proactive and really begin to believe for those moments and those opportunities that we're going to be able to share Christ, what he has done in my life. And so, Lord, we're just believing that right now. We're believing that, Jesus, you said the harvest is already ripe. And so, God, we're believing, Lord, that even we may not see it, we may not know what's going on in their life, but we believe that in some way the Holy Spirit is preparing their heart, that many are ready, God. And what's lacking is the harvesters. So send us, Lord. Send us to our harvest field, our Jerusalem, Lord, our family, our friends. And Lord, and we know that it won't stop there because we will go beyond that and we will go to the ends of the earth, God. Lord, our heart for missions will begin to expand and enlarge into our Judea, our Pittsburgh region, God. Hallelujah. Lord, we just thank you for that right now. God, we're just believing, Lord. We're believing for these moms, dads, sisters, brothers, aunts, uncles, best friends. God, we're believing for them right now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, we're going to go to the slide then, trying to cover these questions: why, who, how, when, where. I think these are practical questions, and I want to give some practical answers and ideas on how to share the gospel with our relatives, friends in our Jerusalem, but we also need to be ready to share the gospel with foreigners, with strangers. Because you see, in the Bible, in the book of Acts and in the Gospels, you see our Lord Jesus Christ saying to the disciples, go. He sends them away, and he sends them to preach the gospel. And they go to cities and villages that they don't know anybody. Paul goes to every city and he doesn't know anybody in all the cities he went to. Then in the book of Acts also, where when the persecution comes, the Bible says that all that believed and were scattered away, they went preaching everywhere they went. And I doubt they had relatives and friends. And they were escaping. They were fleeing for their lives. But they went preaching the gospel also to those that didn't know them. So we have to have both ideas. We need to be ready to share the gospel with our friends. And that's, we were having coffee this morning and someone said this to me and I agree. The problem that we have when we share Christ with those that know us, and the reason why we don't do it is because if we tell them, then we are committed to live differently and according to what we are saying. And so because we don't want to do that, we don't want to tell them anything. I believe that's one of the traps that the devil is making us believe. Subconsciously, we do that. We don't want to tell them, because if we tell them, my friends, my relatives, my coworkers, my boss, my subordinates, my schoolmates, whatever, I mean, people near me, if I tell them and they see me every day, then I don't want them to kind of hold me accountable or hold this against me. So I better don't tell them anything. You know, so I'm off the hook. So I feel safer in not saying anything. But that's not being on the will or in the will of the Lord, because the will of God is for us to tell them. And if we tell them this, yes, we are, then we are committed to holding our lives according to what we say. So you see, there is this two-way street. If we tell them, this is my cousin, my brother, my sister, my relative, if I tell them, then I need to live differently, right? But that's the challenge. That's the challenge. But then we also need to realize that it is not, the power of transformation does not belong to us. The transformation taking place is taking place because he who began a good work in you will complete it, right? He who began a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. So I am not being transformed because I am changing myself. And I am not becoming a better person just because I want to be a better person. He is making me a follower of Christ. He is making me more into his image. He is making me a child of his family, So let's try to cover these questions, why, who, how, when, and where. Why do we do it? Then we need to use this, the handout that I gave you, or we gave you. Follow me, I will make you fishers of men. Why do we share the gospel? Why do we preach the gospel? Number one, it is the will of God. It is the will of God that we preach the gospel. So I think we don't need to say much about that. But just remember, 1 Timothy chapter 2, Paul says to Timothy, I urge you, brethren, above all things to pray, and to pray for authorities, those who are in authority, and for all men, because God wants all men to be saved. So God wants everyone to be saved. And then Peter says in 2 Peter chapter 3 that God doesn't want anybody to get lost. He wants all of them to be saved, and he doesn't want anybody getting lost. So it is the will of God that we preach the gospel. Number two, it is a mandate. In John chapter 20, verse 21, our Lord Jesus is in the midst of the disciples, and he comes and says to them, just like the Father sent me, now I send you. So from the very beginning, he is telling the disciples, now you do this too. It's not like you take your time, you go home and you think about this, you pray about it and see if the Lord is speaking. No. He says, if you follow me, I will make you fishers of men. If you follow me, you will be my disciples, and I will take you even to the ends of the earth, beginning in Jerusalem. And you go tell them. Pastor Patrick was reminding us of these scriptures. So why do we do this? Because it is the will of God. Who does it? Who is in charge of doing this? All of us. All of us are called to do this. Sharing the gospel. Preaching the gospel. Number two, it is a mandate. In Matthew chapter 28, that's the Great Commission scripture that we all know. Therefore, go into all the world and make disciples. So that therefore is the mandate, is the command. Therefore, you have to do this. You do it. Do you agree? You don't have to agree. Do you like it? You don't have to like it. I mean, it sounds like a mandate. Yes, it is a mandate. It is a command that he has given us. The problem with us is that we read scriptures and we want to understand what we want to understand from them. And we want to read what we want to read in them. But if we want to hear his will and to know his will, we need to read the Bible like it is. And he gives a mandate about going and preaching. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, Paul says, woe unto me if I don't preach the gospel. He says, it is a mandate. It has been given me this command, and if I don't do it, Paul says, I cannot stop the preaching of the gospel. But then he also says, but I don't do it out of obligation. I do it because I love him. So that's the second thing. Number three, the love of Christ compels us. Why do we share the gospel? Why do we want to share the gospel with others? Because we, the love of Christ, we have enjoyed meeting the love of Christ in our lives, haven't we? I mean, I know he loves me. I know he died for me. All he did it for me. He loves me. And so knowing that love, knowing his love, experiencing his love, being encapsulated, and Paul, this is what Paul is trying to convey to us in this chapter, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. He says, the love of Christ compels us. The love of Christ pushes us to do this. It's out of love that we do it, because he loves us. I know he loves me. I am enjoying his blessings, and he loves them. The ones that are lost, he loves them just as much as he loves me. You know, that's a revelation and understanding that I got, that I received from him in the very early days of my walk with him. Because when in my city, in Guatemala, a little neighborhood that we come from, a very small, poor section of the city, we don't have streets. It's alleys. You know, it's little alleys. I remember running and playing and hiding and doing crazy things in that area of the city. And the picture he gave me when he revealed this to me, how much he loves me, was that I was running, you know, and walking and running and living my life. And he said to me, and I pursued you, and I went after you, and I looked for you, and I waited for you. I went after you, and I remember that. I remember my friends, among them my wife, telling me about Christ, telling me the gospel, telling me the Bible, inviting me to church. Yes, you need to invite people to, of course, the church is very important in the life of the believer, but the believer, I mean, when you share Christ with people, the reason why I say don't talk about church is because you give them the opportunity to complain and to attack the congregations. I'm not saying don't talk about your church because I'm saying you shouldn't or it's not good. No. Of course, the local church is God's, I mean, the body of Christ. So we need to talk about the body of Christ and the local church, but there is a time and a place for you to introduce that new person, the lost, the unsaved, to the programs and to the reasons why we come to church and why we belong to our local congregation and the benefits and the blessings that God gives to us if we come together, when we come together. Yeah, so there is a place for you to invite and to tell them to come to a program, to a meeting, to a special event. Yes, you have to do that. But what I mean is, don't talk about all my church, all my denomination, all my pastor, all my... If you do that, then they will have arguments, because so many things are happening in what we call church today. And we don't want to give them that opportunity. So number three, the love of Christ compels us, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And then John says, look, I mean, what kind of love is this? What love the Father has given to us that now he calls us the children of God. So the love of Christ is the one that pushes us. It encourages us. The love of Christ, the experience that we have had with his love, we cannot keep it to ourselves. And so when I understood how much he loved me and how much he waited for me, I went, wow, that's the same way he went after me for many years. That's how he's doing it right now with so many. But he's wanting us, he's needing us to go and tell them once more, tell them. Pray for them, communicate to them, share with them, love them, and until their hearts are convinced by the Holy Spirit. Number four will be, the laborers are few. There are few laborers. People, we need workers. In Pittsburgh, we need people out in the streets, in our communities, willing to tell people about Christ. Number five, it is harvest time. We always try to think that because of what we see, God is moving or God is not moving, because we are governed by our natural senses. That was happening to the disciples back then in chapter 4. They were walking, you know, it's Israel and many of those countries are agricultural economies. So they were walking and they see the fields, and our Lord, knowing what is happening in their minds and in their economy, he says, you think harvest time comes in 3-4 months in the natural? And they went, yeah, it's, we still need 3-4 months in the natural. But he, Jesus, says to them, but I tell you the truth, spiritually, the fields are white. And you know, when the expression, the fields are white, it means the fruit is matured, it's ready. It's almost like falling on the ground and perishing. That's the idea. The harvest are white, meaning the harvest is ripe right now. We need to go and grab it and get it because it's perishing. And you know, if you had, I was growing up in, when I grew up, well, I grew in Guatemala. We had a tree in my house back then, and that tree was so fruitful. We gave fruit all the time. So we had, I don't know what you call it. I don't know, you have it in the States. It's a small round. The shape is like water drops, and it's yellow, and it's very sweet and juicy. It's delicious, really good. And it kept falling and falling and falling and falling because it gave so much fruit. And so I always have that picture when I think about this passage, the fruit being perishing. So you know what we did? We gathered it and we sold it. It was a good way of making money for us as children. We picked it up and we sold it. But we need to apply this mentality to the harvest that the Lord is preparing in Pittsburgh. The harvest is ready. The field is white unto harvest. And so we need to, number 5, it is harvest time. Harvest time is not only in the natural, it only happens. How many times can you gather, pick a harvest in your fields, depending on corn, wheat, rice? Once or twice, right? I don't know anything about that physical thing. Spiritually, it's harvest time. It's harvest time all the time for the kingdom of God. If you keep reading chapter 4 of John, you will read the following. I will paraphrase it to you. Jesus keeps talking to them and says, I am sending you, listen to me, I am sending you to a field that you never worked in, that you did not prepare. You are going to be gathering a harvest, the one that you didn't work for. He's saying that to the disciples. You did not prepare the harvest. You were not plowing the ground. You did not prepare the ground. You didn't sow the seed. You didn't water it. You didn't take care of it. You didn't see it grow. You didn't do anything. You are just going to gather it. That's what he's saying to us. Now that brings a different meaning and understanding to the passage. Because not only the harvest is ready, but he's telling us, go and get it. And you haven't done anything for it. Because it is the Holy Spirit doing the work. Not only in the U.S., but in many parts of the world, we are seeing a harvest. Muslim countries, people are coming to Christ. In Israel, people are coming to Christ. In Africa, in Asia, in many, many places in the world, there is harvest ready. So the harvest is ready today. That's what he's saying there. Number 6, we have the word of reconciliation. We not only have the word of reconciliation, but we also have the ministry of reconciliation. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 18 and 19. We have been given the words of reconciliation and the ministry of reconciliation. Reconciling, what does reconciling mean? It means bringing two parts or two parties together again into agreement. But you need to step in between. That's why we have our Lord Jesus Christ. He had to come to step in between. God's love and God's wrath on us, sinners, to be reconciled with God. And so he's calling us, he's saying to us that we have the words of reconciliation and the ministry of reconciliation. So when we go out, this is one of our priesthood duties. Can you believe that? We are priests unto him, for him. I mean, that blows my mind away. I'm a representative of his in the nations, in the world. In Pittsburgh today, I am here to bring reconciliation between God and people, between people and God, and then between people. That's the ministry we have. So our ministry is so important, not only spiritually, but also socially and locally. We are the ones that bring people together. We heal relationships. Number one, the relationship between God and man and woman. And then among ourselves. We bring reconciliation. We bring restoration. We bring recovery to people. So that's why we preach the gospel. Now, I want to go to the following. And I don't know if you were able to take... Okay, there you go. Thank you. You don't have a handout for that. And these are 2, 4, 5 points that I want to cover with you. The gospel of the kingdom. What is the message of the gospel? You know, because when we read Mark chapter 3, verse 14, the Bible says that he called the disciples unto him to send them to preach. If you read Mark chapter 3, verse 14, that's what it says. He called the disciples to be with him and to send them to preach. That speaks of the twofold calling that we have. Many of us think that we are called to be with him, and that's it. But we are not only called to be with him. As he called us to be with him, he calls us to send us out. Now, when he calls us to be with him, he does several things, and he reveals the Father to us. That's one of the main reasons why they killed Jesus, because he revealed that God was not only God, but he is also our Father. And he began by teaching us how to pray. Pray to the Father in heaven. And then every time he spoke about God, he didn't say God, he said my Father, our Father. And that's what he reveals to us when we spend time with him. When we spend time with Jesus, he reveals the Father to us. And that makes a big difference. Why? Especially in a society like in the one we are living today, where the father figure is destroyed, the man, the father, the head of the house is gone, is out of the picture, and you have single mothers, or fathers having two women, or women having two husbands. So the father figure, it's the center of the devil's attack all the time. Because by destroying families, by destroying parents, by destroying the family unit, he is destroying, Paul reveals it later on in his writings. He says, this is the mystery hidden for ages. Christ is the head. And the church is his wife, the bride. It's the mystery. That's why you see in the book of Genesis, I love speaking about families, because in the book of Genesis, you see marriage first, before anything else, you see marriage established. Then their relationship with God comes second. Am I saying marriage is first? No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying how the Lord puts marriage into perspective. And so when we take the message of the gospel, the message of the kingdom, we need to remember that Jesus calls us to be with him, and when he calls us to be with him, he reveals the Father to us. And that's something that we need to restore in our teaching and in our preaching and in our practice in Christianity today too. The importance of having the family united and restored. and functioning according to biblical principles. He reveals the Father, but then he also transforms us. When we spend time with him, he transforms us, and he equips us, and he sends us out. Mark chapter 3, verse 14. That's the calling of God on our lives. He calls us to be with him, and he sends us out. But what's the message of the kingdom? Because he sends the disciples and says, go into the world and preach the gospel. Now, what is the message? What is the message that we need to take? If you go to Luke 24, you don't have it there. Luke 24, verse 47, the Bible says, Jesus says, and he ordered and he ordained, speaking of the Father, he ordained that the gospel be preached. But he says, repentance and forgiveness of sins be preached through the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. So what is the message of the kingdom of God? Repentance and forgiveness. Now the repenting comes from the Holy Spirit. That's why we need to be in prayer all the time, praying for the salvation of people and praying for the preaching of the gospel, that the Holy Spirit will continue and will make hearts think and feel and repent. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. We are gathering here and we pray and we are praying and getting ready, but we are trusting and believing that as we are preparing, and the reason why we are preparing for this is because he is at work in the hearts of people outside. And he is speaking to us as his body, because he wants us to connect the dots and see the rejoicing of new lives coming to Christ. So when the Bible says he commands that repentance and forgiveness of sins be preached, that's the message we take to people. Your sins are forgiven if you believe, if you put your trust in Jesus. It doesn't matter, your background, how dark, how sinful, how deep you were involved in sin, in any kind of sin, there is forgiveness if you repent. If you are willing to give your heart to Jesus Christ, he has given his life for the forgiveness of your sins. So there is no guilt, no condemnation if you believe in Christ. Your sins are forgiven. Your name is written in the book of life. The statement against you has been torn away on the cross. God doesn't see you as a sinner anymore if you believe in Christ. So the message of the kingdom is a message of hope and restoration. But then the second part of the message of the kingdom, because when you read the Gospels, Jesus says, until this gospel of the kingdom, Matthew chapter 24, is preached in all the nations as a testimony to all the world, then the end will come. He's saying the gospel of the kingdom. And that's something that we need to understand. The gospel of the kingdom, the good news of the kingdom, that means there is a king and there is a kingdom. And that king is the King of Kings. And he is coming with a kingdom that cannot be shaken, a kingdom that cannot be overthrown. That's what, remember, the prophets said, and that's what John the Baptist also said. Behold, the kingdom of God is at hand. But when Jesus, our Lord, comes, he says, the kingdom is here. And the message of the kingdom is a message that we, in Christian circles, have forgotten and have lost. Because now we live and we walk according to whatever we feel and whatever we want and whatever is in style, whatever is in trend, that's how we behave. No. We have a king and we have a kingdom. We belong to a king and we belong to a kingdom. We are not to live the way we want to live, but we need to live according to the standards and the rules in the kingdom. So the message of the kingdom also, it's very important that we preach it and tell people, because one thing we do is that we tell people, give your life to Jesus and you will be saved. But we also need to invite people to become servants of Christ. Submit to Christ and his word and his commandments. Lordship of Jesus Christ. And that comes in discipleship, which will be in coming up. Then number two, each one reach one. Each one of us reaching one. That's the key to personal evangelism. You can do it, we can do events. Events are good, events are needed. But if you have noticed, events don't bring much fruit these days. You do all the cooking, all the baking, all the advertisement. You invest all the money you invest. You bring a band. Now it's not a worship team, but a band. You bring the lights and the smoke, and which is, I'm not speaking against that at all. But I'm saying we don't see results. And the result we want to see is not just having a good crowd. Good crowds are good, but we need to be concerned with who is born again. We need to be praying, and our effort should be to see people being born again. And for that, we need to pray, and we need to preach the gospel. Because events only gather people. But personal evangelism, it gives us the commitment. It requires a commitment from each one of us to be always sharing the gospel, on your guard, praying, prepared to share, preparing in serving, inviting people, driving to bring people, or perhaps they drive, but still you have to go and get them because they don't want to come or they don't want to attend the meetings. So each one reaching one. If we could go home thinking about reaching one in the coming months. No pressure, no obligation, but let's say by December, we all should have somebody new in Christ coming to church with us. That's a commitment I need to make in my heart. Not with me, not with your... But before the Lord, a commitment that I will look for someone, I will pray for someone, like we just did. You wrote the names down. Okay, you need to keep praying for those two or three names that you put down on that paper. And pray and pray and pray. Each one reaching one. Number three, be intentional. Be intentional. Be proactive. Be strategic, be creative, and be prepared. So you see, it all takes the effort, and the work is on us. Spiritually, he is working, but he still needs us to reach people. So be intentional. And this is part of being intentional. I mean, Pastor Patrick is praying and being intentional in doing this. And this is only the first time this is happening. Because training for evangelism takes more sessions and more practice. I wish we would have more time to really actually practice. Like teach you how to share scriptures, five scriptures from the New Testament, and start a conversation, and ways in leading your conversation so you take people to praying. The repentance prayer, you know, committing your life to Christ, that will take another half an hour perhaps to show you the five scriptures, how to lead the conversation, and then how to pray for people, and what to do next. That will take practice. Then we need to think about going out with these signs, which is making you scared and afraid already. You know, like, oh, I don't think I want to do that. Well, you don't want to do that now, and we will not take you out right now. But with training and prayer, you're going to be like, oh, yeah, I think I can do this, you know. God will start giving you the strength and 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 the heart to, okay, I'm going to stand out there, you know, in the corner, yo, hoping my friends don't see me. I will use the sign and just, you know, so they don't see who it is. That's okay. Baby steps. Yeah, that's okay. We can do that. We should do that next time. So be intentional in everything we do. Be intentional. Be proactive. Be creative. Be prepared to share the gospel. Being intentional meaning, okay, look for ways. Look for ways to start the conversation. Look for ways. I mean, not that you are pushy. No, I'm not saying you are pushy. No. I don't mean you be disrespectful to people either. No. But when you are intentional, when you are creative, when you are proactive, when you are ready, then you find ways to do it. God will give you the ways to do it, to start the conversation with a question. God will open an opportunity for you. God will give you an opportunity, and you need to be ready. You need to be ready and quick to say, okay, this is my chance. And you say a word. You share the gospel. You tell them. And then discipleship. So be intentional. Go back to the names that you wrote on the paper. What can you do on your part? What initiative can you take in approaching the people in that list, on that list, those people? What initiative can you take so that, let's say, in 1 month, you will be able to share the gospel with them in a clear way? Sharing the gospel doesn't mean, you know, there is Mother's Day coming up, so I'm buying the ticket for you. Can you come? That's not sharing the gospel. That's inviting people to an event. Yes, please. Mother's Day is coming up, and I know there is a banquet or a breakfast or a special meeting. Please invite someone and pay for them. That's an excellent idea. That's something really, really good to do. Yes, but I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about you inviting someone for coffee or watching a game Sunday night, Monday night, you know, ballpark, whatever, and because that's very cultural here. I like it. I like it. I like baseball. I only watched it on TV before. Now I'm waiting to go to the park one day. I will. My wife and I went to go to the to see a game. Like, wow, you know, we want to do that. So there are many opportunities for you to approach and to come close to someone. Finding a way. Be proactive in finding a way. Like, be creative. God will give you creativity for you to say, to speak in his name, in his favor. So that's what it means, being intentional. So next month, within a month from now, please see the names that you wrote down and say, how can I approach this friend or cousin or whatever, whoever it may be? How can I do this? How can I do this? You know, be intentional. Do it. Okay, discipleship. Discipleship is key and very important once you share the gospel with someone and that someone commits to Christ. And actually discipleship starts even before people committing to Christ. You see that in scriptures. We have disciples that came to know Christ, that encounter our Lord, that were already looking and searching for him. And so God had already been working in their lives. In my case, I came out of the Jehovah's Witnesses. And I think someone asked me how was it that I came out of Jehovah's Witnesses and why did I come to Christ? And the reason for that is because, remember I told you my dreams? That dream never stopped, even though I went to the Jehovah's Witnesses for a year and a half. And it was crazy. I don't like Jehovah's Witnesses at all. God's presence is not there, of course. It's not there. I read the Bible, but I don't remember what I read ever. I don't remember anything I read with them. I went through all their magazines. They tell you, we study the Bible. They don't study the Bible. They read a magazine. They read a manual they have. And then they visit the Bible, their Bible. And then they go back to their book and their magazine. That's what they do. But they tell them they're studying the Bible. But that's not true. They're reading their materials, and they visit the scripture. So if one of the writers says heaven will be on earth, they quote the scripture and they go to the Bible. Oh yeah, the heaven will be on earth. It will come down. Okay, yes. And they go back to this material. But they're not reading the Bible. They never read the Bible on their own, because they're not prohibited to do it, but it's advised not to read the Bible on their own. They need to have their materials, and they have to have someone with them to teach them the Bible. That's how they work, and it works. You see, it works. Discipleship works. For the good or for the bad, it works. They're doing it for the bad. It works. You see how they grow, because they're training materials. They stick to the training material. They do it. They do it. They teach it. They repeat it. They do it. They do it. And they don't take long for them to put a new person in charge of another person. They do it right away. And it's part of their mentality. You need to do this. You need to do this. They teach them to do that very rapidly. We in Christian circles, we never train people to be disciples and to disciple others. That's one of our weaknesses. So we need discipleship, but then discipleship doesn't mean only teaching from books or from materials, or in our case, from scriptures. Preaching and teaching, and repeating messages and preachings. But rather, not only that, but also living with them. Not that you move into their house or they into your house, but creating that fellowship, that closeness. That's why local congregations are so important, because that's where discipleship takes place. Because if you know where I live and I know where you live, then if your front yard is not taken care of, I will know and you will know. If I take my trash out, if I take care of my yard, my house, you will know that. It's not that you're judging me and me judging you, but we hold each other accountable, right? Discipleship does that. So discipleship, it's that's another subject. Discipleship is investing your life, investing your time, investing your resources, opening your home, opening your house, your living room, your table for people to come and eat and have fellowship with you. Book of Acts. We don't have to go to the Book of Acts to see that in action. But that was one of the core practices. They broke bread and they met daily at the temple? No, at the house and in the temple. But they also met in the houses, in the homes. And when the persecution came, they couldn't go to the temples anymore. And when people knew that they were followers of the way, Jesus Christ, then they moved out of the temple, of the religious Jewish temple, and they had to stay in the homes. So discipleship happens rather in the houses, at home. We are coming to find with my wife that most of the, I don't know if that happens here with this congregation, but many congregations have Bible studies, but one Bible study meets there, another one there, another one there, another one downstairs, because no one is willing to open their homes. And I go, we go, wait a minute. No. Discipleship, the Bible study, discipleship, fellowship should be done in my house, like we do it. Thursday night, my house. You're welcome for dinner. Right, Brian? You are served dinner. We eat. We fellowship. And we study the Bible. Right, Brian? That's how we do it. That's how we see it in the Bible. And you see it in Deuteronomy chapter 6. This you will teach to your children. Teach it to your children. So my daughter and my wife are talking right now. And my wife says to them, Dad is teaching this morning. And my daughter says, oh, how I miss hearing my dad preach. My daughter says that about me. Ha ha, I'm so happy. Because she saw us, she grew up with us preaching and teaching. In the streets, yes. In the church where we met, yes. But they remember our teaching time in our house. And that's heavy on the children. I mean, good heavy. It weighs. It's a testimony. We are so blessed to have our two daughters following the Lord. One of them living in Philadelphia, another one in Wilkes-Barre, in going to college. And my little one, Ellie, from Wilkes-Barre. Yeah, bar. And so Barbary.
So you say all of them.
I say all of them. So she's there going to college, and you know, she calls me one night and she says, "Dad, I'm reading." No, we were driving, and she says, "Dad, I'm reading one of the prophets." And she says, Dad, who's this prophet? Who's he speaking to? Why is he saying this?" And I'm driving, and I'm going. I told her, and we hung up, and we go, "Isn't that something? Your daughter calling you? She's a 20-year-old in college, and she's calling me to ask me questions because I'm reading this prophet, but I don't understand what he's saying and why he's saying this." Oh, okay. She calls me. I love it. I'm bragging, I'm sorry. But because of discipleship, my point is discipleship. Brothers and sisters, I'm going to speak to the men, if you let me, please. I'm going to speak to the men. You are the head of the house. I mean, God's responsibility is on your shoulders, not the wife. Anything and everything, and I am putting myself on the spot right here. Anything and everything that happens under your roof is your responsibility. I'm speaking to the men, okay? Men. It's your responsibility. Good or bad, it's your responsibility. Today, I'm so happy and blessed to report that everything is going well in my house today. I don't promise anything about tomorrow. Can't promise. But today, my one daughter is 23 years of age. The second one is 20. Neither of them have had boyfriend. In Guatemala, we don't do the idea of dates, which is very, I don't like it. The dating thing, we go, that's a little something. We don't like it. We don't see it in scriptures. We never encourage that. It's not part of our culture back in Guatemala, so we don't have any issues with that. We see that now here in the States, and we go, "Oh, wow, okay. You know, it's like, okay, that's the way they want it, okay. You know, I can't do anything. But that's an observation that we are able to make. So today, 20 years of age, 23 years of age, no boyfriend at all, which we are beginning to wonder, "Please, Lord, you know, bring the guy around, please, because we want to see grandchildren." You know, but it's not like my daughter had one and second and third one. And no. And no, nothing like that. So that's good. I mean, I love it. I'm so proud in a good sense, if you understand what I'm saying. I'm so proud of that. And we know, my wife and I know, that it is just because the grace of God in our lives. But still, I had a role and I had a responsibility, and I still have it today with my daughters. So that's why I can say to you men, anything and everything that happens under your roof is your responsibility, good or bad. If it's good, praise God and be proud, and that's really good for you, for your manhood. It's good. It's wonderful. If it's bad, okay, confess it, repent, and change. But it is your responsibility, and you need to take responsibility for it. But because we start complaining and throwing guilt and, "No, it's her fault," and you are avoiding your responsibility. And you are saying, "God, you are wrong. I'm okay. I'm right and you are wrong." No, take responsibility. I'm saying all that because of discipleship. Discipleship has to happen in the house. And in the house, you, the men, have to take charge. Okay. I said it. Discipleship is more than teaching Bible. teaching Bible is a big part of discipleship, of course. That's what we teach. We teach principles, Bible principles, and life-changing principles from scriptures. But it's more than just teaching, being a good teacher, or having a good message, or being a good preacher. It's more than that. It's more than that. Discipleship is more than coming to church on Sundays. Discipleship is more than coming together for just a Bible study. Discipleship, it's a life commitment and a life transformational process. And then finally, releasing into ministry. And this is another thing that in my preaching and teaching in the U.S., I'm being strong in this. Discipleship and releasing is very important for the church to what's the word I'm looking for? For the expansion, for the growing, for the going, for the growth numerically and spiritually of the kingdom of God in this country and in the nations. Discipleship and the releasing of people into ministry. My wife and I were blessed by being born again in a congregation where this is practiced today. We were discipled. We were sharing with our sister that we've been in ministry 25 years, and that's how long we have been married. Because as soon as we married, well, before marrying, I was already in ministry. But we count our ministry together since we got married. Because I got saved when I was 18 years of age. I immediately went to Bible school. I finished my first Bible school. I went into ministry, evangelistic ministry, youth ministry, and then an associate pastor, and I got married and went into ministry, back into ministry. So I never came out of ministry since I came to Christ. But that happened because we were discipled, trained and equipped, and then we were released for ministry. And so our ministry grew, we developed our ministry in the nations, and then very short story, we are now here in the States as missionaries. But it's been since day one. I remember my first days going to the house of my pastor. I actually attended my pastor's Bible study at his house. And then when my dad kicked me out of the house because I got involved in ministry, after a few months he said, "I've prayed and my wife and I have talked and we want you to come to our house." So I moved in with my pastor. I mean, that doesn't happen. I'm not saying that you should do that. I'm not saying that. But that's my experience. But why? Because the kind of pastors that we had that kind of commitment, investing their lives into somebody else, into many. We are just one of them. So discipleship and releasing into ministry are key to the expansion of the kingdom of God. The gospel of the Lord needs to keep being preached and keep going. So we want to see, we not only want to see you growing numerically, but we also want to see you developing the ministry that the Lord has given to you, and you developing that ministry that can be planting another church, being a missionary, or being an assistant pastor, or planting a sister church here but we need to think in these terms, equipping and releasing people. So when you see people outside, like we do with my wife, we are saying, wow, imagine if such and such will come to Christ. Wow, she will be such a blessing. That's how Jesus saw them before they came to him. Oh, Peter, oh, Simon, I call you Peter now because I see something in you. We need to see things in people. We need to read beyond what is holding people back from coming to Christ. We need to see beyond that. God has many gifts given among us and even talents outside that he can use. That's why I believe that that's one of the reasons why he chose Paul, because of what he saw in Paul. Okay. Releasing into ministry. And the releasing into ministry may also mean sending missionaries. Glassport Assembly of God sending their own missionaries. Not only sending your missionary gift offering to, where is the headquarters? Springfield, which is great. Thank you for doing that. Please keep supporting the missionaries that Springfield supports. Please keep praying and giving so more missionaries can go. But wouldn't it be wonderful to have the Lord call some of you into different ministries? And one of them, because that's my passion, missions. That would be wonderful. That would be amazing. Amen. Okay, I want to close here, and I want to end with just perhaps one or two questions. No questions. Good. Whew, I'm good. I'm off the hook. Debbie. The reason why I want to end with a couple of questions, just two questions, because I know there are so many questions and so many things that we didn't get to cover because of time, but this is going to continue, I believe.
And they're not trying to stop me from talking. They want to hear what I have to say, but, you know, and I look at her and I try, you know, to say it's okay, but that interruption is strong. So what do you, am I wrong to keep, you know, pressing forward? I mean, unless somebody says, you know, I'm not interested in what you have to say, I'm usually back down. But, you know, I don't know how to handle that.
If I understood you correctly, I think you are okay. Because if you're trying to share the gospel with someone and you see the door opened and that person willing to hear you, then you're okay. Perhaps you should find another time and another place where you can meet with that someone without the other someone interrupting you, interrupting or getting in the way. And by what you said, I think you implied that that other interrupter, it's a Christian.
Yeah. So I mean, crazy. It's a baby Christian.
A baby Christian.
Definitely a baby Christian. But, I mean, how do I witness to the baby Christian about, you know, this is our job. This is what we're to do, is to witness to people. You know, it doesn't matter what their beliefs or religion is. We're sharing the good news. Mm-hmm. We're sharing the mm-hmm. truth. Mm-hmm. You know, how do I get that across to her so that she doesn't interrupt?
Well, you will find a way to do that if that's another one of your purposes. Okay. I mean, you have to. Okay, I'm gonna. How can I say this? My wife and I are now in Pittsburgh. And we are now praying to develop a team for the ministry. We need a team. And so in trying to find people for the team, of course, we are meeting people and we are sitting down, we're spending time, we're eating, we're praying, we're talking, we're visiting, we're getting to know, and we are yes, maybe. So what's your purpose? So you need to make a decision. You want to disciple that other one, or you want to reach the lost one, or you want to do both. But you will not be, for what you are saying, it will be a little difficult, especially for the lost one, if you start trying to disciple the other one, because she will see, oh,
yes,
there
I
is.
Can't, I can't do it, obviously.
No, yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. Ever. I mean, there's times there are her friends that I don't always get to see these people. So if there's an opportunity, I feel that she feels that she's so concerned and consumed with the fear of me offending mm-hmm. somebody and what they currently believe, be it right or be it wrong, that's why she has this need to stop it.
Uh-huh.
You know, but I know that's not of God. I mean, I know that. And I, you know, I do need to sit with her and somehow explain this to her, because she is a Christian. And she needs to know the truth as much as someone who hasn't even begun their walk. So, it's...
Well, Falco is providing us a great service, and the reason why he has this paper here is for you. If you want copies of audio copy or video copy, I'm not sure what he's working on, but I was
thinking that about getting copies. I have a life group even is sending the copies out to the entire life group.
That will help. That will help them. Mm-hmm. But then continue sharing. Mm-hmm. We cannot side with the flesh or the fear of this world and not share the gospel with someone. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't stop. But, it's a very particular situation, and I know the Lord will give you wisdom to handle the situation. I will advise you to find a way to make contact with this unsaved person on a different time, in a different place, so you can have the freedom. But make sure she understands that's the purpose of the meeting. Because then, if you don't tell them in advance, then that's what people don't like. Another question, and we pray, we finish. Thank you for your patience with me, with my language, with my English, and I'm enjoying it very much because I'm practicing. Okay. Thank you for being my guinea pigs. You see, I'm practicing. Perhaps guinea pigs is not a good idea, but that's my example. Okay, so we believe in sending, and we love praying two prayers. The two prayers that we love praying are when people come to Christ, leading people in salvation prayer, and commissioning people prayer. And we're going to do commissioning today. Whether you feel like, you don't have to feel like you are equipped or enabled or that you are the one that he wants to use. All we want you to be today is willing to say, Lord, if I can be of any help, if I can serve you, please use me. I don't know how to say, I don't know how to start a conversation, I don't know how to preach, I don't know how to prepare a message. You don't worry about that. Don't worry. He has promised that when he puts you in the spot, he says to the disciples, and he says that to us today, my spirit will give you the words you need to say at that very moment. So don't worry. Okay? Amen? So could you stand? And Pastor?
Amen. Once you pray that prayer with us, okay? Who wants to be sent?
Hallelujah.
Come on, let's raise our hand.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father God, can we sing a song? Can we worship the Lord as we prepare our hearts to be sent by him? Here I am, send me to the nations. That's going to the nations.
I think we know this song here. I think most of us know. Lord, prepare me.
There you go.
To be a sanctuary. Pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
Once again, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary.